I had no longer within me the sense of final success. I had the instinctive feeling that the outcome would prove unfortunate. Napoleon Bonaparte. Napoleon moved quickly and reintroduced liberal sentiments to the French people. At the same time, he sought emissaries to disrupt the forming of a coalition by opening secret communications with the representatives. For example, sending one to his father-in-law, Emperor Francis of Austria, telling of his new peaceful intentions. This was encouraged by rumors of Napoleon being sick. This is still debated by historians to this day. The Austrians told him they would accept Napoleon's son on the throne, with him as regent. In an attempt to win British favor, he abolished the slave trade. Seeing that the Prussians wanted revenge for their defeats, he instead focused on Russia and sent a secret treaty to Tsar Alexander that supported the Tsar's Polish scheme by war if necessary. But all had no effect. Murat's attack swiftly put an end to this, and troops still moved to take France. Napoleon rose another army, but there was one major drawback. One of Louis's more popular decisions was to ban conscription. Napoleon had only 200,000 men from the Royal Army, and so had to reintroduce it, which added a further 100,000 men, but also taking 150,000 men from the National Guard, which were local militia units. Many of the marshals within this army were new, like Marshal Grouchy, created before the campaign, even though Marshal Davout advised against it. But Napoleon insisted. But some of the exceptions were, after the death of Berthier, who died shortly before Napoleon returned to power. He was a master administrator. His loss would weigh heavily on the Army du Nord. He was replaced by Marshal Soult. Soult had big shoes to fill, but was a veteran of the Peninsular Campaign. He rose from the ranks and fought with Arthur Wellesley, Duke of Wellington, before. However, he lost. Napoleon called him the Great Maneuverer. Another one of the key marshals of this campaign, and a veteran of the prior campaigns, was Marshal Ney. He also rose from the ranks and fought bloody battles across Europe. He had an extraordinary courage and a cool head in battle, but detested Soult. They would be crucial to the coming battles, as the marshals made independent commands and large roles were supposed to be imaginative and make difficult decisions, such as Grouchy was to keep the Prussians busy while Napoleon defeated the Anglo-Dutch forces. Napoleon recruited another army, splitting it into quarters, one to suppress the southeastern royalist regions, another to garrison Paris, another along the Rhine to hold a massive Austrian army in place, the rest going to the Kingdom of the Netherlands to defeat the first Allied armies to arrive, the Anglo-Dutch forces and the Prussians. This was the Army du Nord, or the Army of the North, composed of 360,000 trained men and 125,000 experienced men. Their objectives were to break the coalition forces in Flanders before the Russians could arrive, gambling on the fact that the coalition would break if the British forces were defeated. As previously mentioned, they were the coalition's paymaster, and a defeat might lead to a change in government, putting the Whigs in power, who more favored Napoleon, causing the United Kingdom to leave the coalition. The campaign in Flanders, known as the Hundred Days Campaign, began on June 12, 1815. The French objective was to keep the armies of the Prussians under Blücher and the Anglo-Dutch forces of Arthur Wellesley apart, as the French forces were roughly the same number as the Allied or Prussian forces separated, but together they outnumbered them. To do this, the French would advance swiftly between the two coalition forces, pinning one down before finally eliminating the other army and regrouping when the Russians arrived. Napoleon calculated if he could accomplish this, the other allies would lose heart. Napoleon would have to face the two generals. The first, under the Prussians, was Prince Gerhard Liebhardt von Blücher of Prussia, 72 and facing bouts of madness at the time. When he began his career, he fought the Prussians with the Swedes, but after being captured was commissioned by Frederick the Great. His nickname was Marshal Forwards, for his habit of yelling, "Männer, forwards!" Blücher was vastly experienced, serving in the Prussian army since the Seven Years' War. He was a cavalryman, employing brilliant staff officers and loved by his men. But in 1815, he was fanatically moved forward to avenge the defeat at Jena with the new style of the Prussian army after army reforms in 1813. The two major reforms of the Prussian army were conscription, introduced into law in 1813, that made all Prussian males that were liable to serve for 3 years in the regular army at the age of 20, followed by 2 years in the active reserve, followed by another 2 years in the active reserve, and then 14 years in the Landwehr, or territorial armies, gambling on a combination of patriotism and compulsion, it would make it without the revolutionary ideals of nations such as France, employing similar methods far earlier. The other was promoting equality in battle that they desired in regular life. Before setting out on this campaign, "Get me a national army," Blücher begged the reformers, and the conscripts and landwehr enthusiastically enlisted in 1815, tripled the size of his army. A table was placed in the center of a square, at which several officers were enlisting those who offered themselves. The crowd was so great that we had to wait 10 until 1 o'clock before we could have a chance of having our names taken. Franz Lieber. The landwehr battalions were so-so at first, but after they had tasted plenty of powder, they did as well as the battalions of the line, Gerhard von Blücher. A substantial part of Blücher's army consisted of raw levies capable of two maneuvers, going forward in a state of disorder, or going backward in a state of chaos. Peter Hofstra, historian. The second of these reforms was the founding of the Order of the Iron Cross that broke the rules of Prussian society, which was one of the most autocratic kingdoms in Europe. The Iron Cross was a decoration of bravery that could be earned by anyone. One of the staff officers of note is August von Neisenhow, who fought with the British in the American Revolutionary War, where his thoughts on the British army were soured, and he was suspicious of the British's ability and intentions. Blücher's high regard for his advice did not bode well for relations between the two sides, especially after the annexation of Saxony, which nearly brought them to war against the British. The other army Napoleon must fight is the Anglo-Dutch forces under the command of Arthur Wellesley, the Duke of Wellington, who described his troops as an infamous army. It was under strength, and many of the Dutch regiments came from the French-speaking parts of Belgium, unhappy of their country's annexation by the Netherlands. Some of them even had fought for Napoleon. Napoleon, knowing this, spread propaganda leaflets among them, encouraging them to defect to his army. One of such read, "To those brave soldiers who have conquered under French eagles, the eagle that have so often led us to victory have reappeared. Their cry is the same, glory and liberty." The Duke, doubtful of the reliability of these regiments, brigaded them with reliable, loyal regiments, such as British, Hanoverian, and the King's German Legion troops. Wellesley had 6,000 King's German Legion, who served with him throughout Spain with distinction. These troops were raised in Hanover, who shared the same king as Britain. They were joined by 16,000 more troops from Hanover, but they were raw. Wellington spread these troops among the British and King's German Legion forces as well, which, as you can imagine, wasn't popular. The English generals were totally unfamiliar with the traditions of the Hanoverians. To them, everything was imperfect, even open to criticism if it didn't conform to the English concerns and institutions. There was no camaraderie, even among the officers. The ignorance of each other's language on both sides, the major differences in pay resulting in great differences in lifestyles, prevented any closer companionship. Even compatriots in the King's German Legion did not associate with us. The 15-year-old ensign with the red sash looked down on the older Hanoverian officer, Captain Karl Jacobi, 1st Hanoverian Brigade. This lack of companionship would be a major problem, as Wellesley's force is multinational, with 16,000 Hanoverians, 40,000 Dutch, half of which were French-speaking Belgians, 6,000 King's German Legion, and 30,000 British. After the Battle of Waterloo, the Duke said, "I had only 35,000 men on whom I could thoroughly rely. The remainder were likely to run away." However, many of the British regiments were not veterans of the Peninsular Army, and some of the best regiments of the Peninsular Army were returning from America after the conclusion of the War of 1812. Only 22 battalions who had fought in Spain had joined Wellington in time for the battle. However, the effective veteran units who arrived to the battle would be lessened, as some of the members were replaced by militia and new recruits. For example, the 52nd Oxfordshire numbered 1,079 men. 558 were new recruits. Even the British Guards were affected by this. They were joined by young soldiers and volunteers from the militia who have been expected to fire on the enemy. However, Napoleon's marshals warned him of the British infantry. Riley annoyed him by saying that they were impregnable, and Soult, who had fought them in Spain, said in a straight fight, "The English infantry were the very devil." Napoleon, who had never faced the British redcoats, dismissed these warnings, saying, "Because you have been beaten by Wellington, you consider him a good general. And now I tell you that Wellington is a bad general, and the English are bad soldiers, and that this affair will be over before lunch." The Prussian and British were both beaten at the battles of Quatre Bras and Ligny. Wellington was pinned by Marshal Ney's wing of the Army du Nord, but the Duke denied Ney the right flank of the Prussians by engaging him at the crossroads of the Nivelle Roads. But the Prussians lost in the end, and the roads that connected the two allies were now captured by the French. The allies were in disarray, as with the loss of the road, it cut their fastest route of communication, and they were forced to use farm roads. By Friday, the Duke received a report saying that the Prussians were lost, and so he sent an aide-de-camp to scout out the area, but only encountered French cavalry patrols. By now, it was obvious what Napoleon would do. He would go down the Nivelle Road and hit Wellington's flank. June 17th, it clouded over during the night, and the dawn was unseasonably cold. The Duke had waited news on the Prussians. In the meantime, the Prussians were discussing their own move. Eisenhower suggested retreating towards the Rhine, but Blücher, who liked and trusted Wellington, ordered a move closer to the Allied forces.
I am 72 and a proud soldier. This steel is my word. I am too old to break it.
If Wellington runs for the coast, none of us will get home to Berlin. The logical road is Namur. I do not trust the English. Nonetheless, because I have served you before, sir, I have ordered the retreat to Wavre. You may still cooperate with Wellington, but God help us if he does not stand.
As opinionated as Eisenhower was, he understood Blücher's talent in warfare, and so the army moved closer to the Allies at Wavre, a move that would be crucial for the coming battle. But by moving to Wavre, the Prussians risked withdrawal to Prussia, but kept the chance of uniting with the Duke's forces alive. The Prussians did this knowing fully well that the French would harry their retreat and attempt to block their movement. The Prussian morale was low, not helped by the rain that began to fall, swelling the saddles of the cavalry, giving the men sores, but the Prussians' mood improved, seeing Blücher's cheerfulness and freshness, as one Westphalian officer put it. Eventually, the Duke of Wellington got the news he needed, that the Prussian army was still in the field and was going to Wavre. The Duke said, "Old Blücher has taken a damn good licking and has gone back to Wavre, 18 miles, and as he's gone back, we must go too. I suppose in England they'll say we've been licked. I can't help it, as they have gone back, we must go too." And so orders a retreat to Mont-Saint-Jean. Wellington carefully planned this withdrawal down the Chaussee Road, in such a manner as should prevent the enemy from observing what we're about. Wellington could go down the Nivelle Road, but that would take him farther away from the Prussians. The retreat started with the infantry and mostly artillery, with the cavalry and light artillery staying behind as a rearguard. The withdrawal was 8 miles. As they went, Wellesley went over the ground he saw a year earlier, considering the ground outside Genappe, but then decided against it, as Mont-Saint-Jean was far better for defense. The withdrawal is difficult, with the threat of the enemy attacking. Wellington wanted this done with little concern, and so pretended to sleep with a paper on his head. All the while, Marshal Ney did nothing. His troops bivouacked at Frons, 3 miles away, and so Wellington's army escaped as black clouds came in from
the... I caught him at Catabras! He's retreating!
If he's retreating, what are you doing here?
Well, I came to make my report!
If Wellington's retreating, what are you doing here? Why didn't you follow him? Why didn't you pursue him?
Where were the reinforcements you promised me?
Don't you dare criticize me! Don't you dare! Don't you see if Wellington's free to choose his ground, everything I've won in this campaign, you've lost?
By 2 a.m., only the rear guard remained, yet they still did not attack, as they would be threatened by the Prussians at Ligny. Napoleon, learning of Ney's inactivity, shamed him. "You have lost France!" he shouted at him. But he was one to talk, as he toured the Ligny battlefield after cavalry patrols reported that Blücher was retreating in disarray. But these were in fact deserting Rhinelanders when Napoleon heard that Wellington was still at Quatrebras and told Ney to hold him while he brings up his army to hit the Duke's left flank, and Grouchy to pursue the Prussians.
Grouchy! Gérard! You take 30,000 men! 30,000 men, one-third of my army. You take them in and you pursue, you understand? You pursue Blücher. You don't let them regroup, you don't let them consolidate, and above all, you don't let them rejoin.
But there are 10 different ways and directions Blücher might go, sire. Wavre, Namur.
Blücher is not a scatter of birds, Marshal Grouchy. We'll find him on one road.
Enough's enough! Let's not have any disagreement. Any disagreement will only lead to disaster. Is that understood? Grouchy, Gérard,
you can go. Go, go, go.
But finding that the Duke withdrew, he pursued them with cavalry and horse artillery. But as the rain came, thunder clapped as lightning lit up the sky. The Duke reported this rain was worse than the monsoon rains in India, and Napoleon notes in his memoir that the rain fell in torrents. Cloudbursts turned the fields into mud. As they marched, the dye in the British uniforms ran, turning their pants pink. The cavalry and horse artillery had to hold the French pursuit. Napoleon sent his cavalry forward, and some of the fiercest fighting was around Genappe, 3 miles from Quatrebras. The French lancers pursued the British hussars and were countercharged by the lifeguards, but British gunners found a vantage point to fire shells at the French cavalry. One battery was of Congreve rockets. Wellington thought they were good for scaring horses, but would gladly be rid of them if they were not the patronage of the Prince Regent. A rain of water and shells dampened the pursuit of the Anglo-Dutch troops as fighting continued throughout the streets of Genappe. Eventually, the Anglo-Dutch forces escaped, with the cannons and wagons on the road, the infantry to the east and the cavalry to the west. A Nassau officer called the work of the officer staff exemplary, as the retreat was efficient despite the weather and the French pursuit, and the British only losing less than 100 men. The French pursuit turned into a struggle against the weather and mud, as they became spread out to the point where the men in Sunyas did not rejoin the rest of them until the following morning, and it rained on, allowing Wellington's troops to escape. One French officer recalled of the weather, "A storm such as I had never seen suddenly unleashed itself upon us. In a few minutes, the road and the plain were nothing more than a swamp, which became ever more impassable because of the storm persisted for the rest of the day and the whole night. The men and horses sank into the mud up to their knees. The growing darkness stopped the troops from seeing each other, and battalions mingled, and each soldier marched as best he could where he could. We were no longer an army, but a crowd." Lieutenant Jacques Martin, French infantry officer. As evening fell, the French cavalry came over the bridge, coming under shell fire. It was dusk and the muzzle flashes came from all along the ridge to the north. The cavalry seeing the guns knew what it meant. The guns had left the road that were placed along the ridge, and the Anglo-Dutch forces intended to defend that ridge and make a stand. The pursuit was over. They were now offering a battle in a place called Mont St.Jean, near the town of Waterloo. The land that surrounded the two encamped armies is a wide valley, its slopes not particularly pronounced. On the southern ridge lay a small roadside tavern called Alliance. The Beautiful Friendship. The southern ridge was mostly higher than the crest of the northern ridge. It rose about 30 meters, or 98 feet, above the valley floor. This slope was not steep. The French army coming north on the road would cross the southern crest by the tavern and see the wide valley just ahead. The ridges were not quite parallel. In some places they were fairly close together, though the roads ran northward from ridge to ridge. The distance between the crests were 1,000 meters or over half a mile. The valley was full of good farmland with tall crops of rye, wheat, and barley growing either side of the road. Then the French would see the northern ridge. The ridge was a gentle long swell of farmland called Mont St.Jean. The north ridge had a straight road dropping gently into the valley, then rising just as gently. On the ridge there were three defensible positions. To the east there was a village huddled around a church and outlying farms that were occupied by troops. Beyond those stone houses the lands were more rugged and the hills and valleys steeper, with no room to maneuver, so the village stood like a fortress. In the center of the ridge, halfway down the slope, was a farm called the Haison. Its houses, barn, and yard surrounded by a wall, which blocked the attack coming straight up the road, while off to the west there was a great house with a walled garden, the Chateau Hougomont. Napoleon's forces would have to take these strong points, or risk devastating flanking fire as their troops advanced to take the ridge. On top of the ridge by La Haison, there was a crossroads, leading to a village further down the road, surrounded by forests further until the road leads to the town of Waterloo. The major strength of this position on the ridge was that the French could not see behind the ridge to the north. All that Napoleon's troops could see were the forests of the St.Jean beyond the crest of the ridge.
That must be the whole army.
They're still positioning, sire.
Never interrupt your enemy when he's making a mistake. That's bad manners, eh?
No, it's a bad position, Wellington. That wood behind us, it's of sound. They push us back. It'll be like a wall. The whole army will be cut to pieces.
There's no undergrowth in that wood. You can drive a battery of 9-pounders. A whole army can slip through it like rain through a grate.
It's suicidal, if you want to know.
It may surprise you to know, Picton, that I saw this ground a year ago. And I've kept it in my pocket.
The rest was hidden, so Wellington's army can move in reserves to areas under attack, move cavalry to attack the flank, or counterattack, all that aside Napoleon and his marshals. All of this made attacking the ridge a risky proposition. However, if the French did not commit to a frontal assault, but attacked on the western flank, where the land was flatter, the position would be made useless, thus making holding Hougomont vital to holding the ridge. As the two armies marched to either side of their valley, the French army continued to gather intelligence on Wellington's army through French-speaking Belgian deserters. A According to Napoleon's memoirs, several officers who had been sent out on reconnaissance and some spies returned at 3:30, confirmed that the English-Dutch troops were not moving. Two Belgian deserters who had just left their regiment told me that their army was preparing for battle and no retreat was happening, and that Belgium was praying for my success, and that the English and Prussians were both equally hated there. The enemy commander could do nothing more contrary to the interests of his cause and his country than to stay in the position that he had occupied. He had behind him the defiles of the force of the St.Jean, and if he were beaten, any retreat would be impossible. The day began to dawn, and I returned to my headquarters, well satisfied with the great error which the enemy commander was making. The British oligarchy would be overthrown by France that day, and was going to ride to a more glorious and powerful and mightier than ever. Through this intelligence, Napoleon knew that Wellington's army was fragile compared to his own of veterans. Now Napoleon's greatest fear of Wellington was that he would retreat during the night. Napoleon's view of Wellington's position was contradicted by Antoine Henri Jomini, a French officer who served as a general in the French army and later in a Russian diplomatic service, and one of the most celebrated writers on the Napoleonic art of war, who pointed out that Wellington had good roads behind his center and wings, which would make retreat through the forest safer than through an open field.
Bad position, Wellington. That wood behind us, it's of sound. If they push us back, it'll be like a wall. The whole army will be cut to pieces.
There's no undergrowth in that wood. You can drive a battery of 9-pounders. A whole army can slip through it like rain through a grate.
It's suicidal, if you want to know.
It may surprise you to know, Picton, that I saw this ground a year ago. And I've kept it in my pocket.
The Duke eventually got word that the Prussians would march to his support. The Prussians were 12 miles away from Mont Saint-Jean. However, this road was hard to cross, going through streams and up steep hills. His next major concern was Napoleon turning his flank and cutting his retreat to Ostend, and so posted 17,000 men in the village of Hal in the morning of the battle. Wellington received a dispatch from Grouchy that the Prussians have gone north of Wavre and were only a few hours' march from Mont Saint-Jean. However, he wasn't alarmed, not responding to this message until mid-morning, as he did send one-third of his army, numbering 33,000 men, to stop them from linking with Wellington. Napoleon wrote, "After a battle such as Flers, Ligny, the junction between the Allies is impossible for at least 2 days. Besides, the Prussians are pressed by Grouchy's detachment, who are at their heels. We are only too pleased that the English wish to accept battle. The battle which they are about to deliver will save France, and will be celebrated in the annals of the world. I shall make use of numerous artillery. I shall launch my horsemen to compel the enemy to unmask, as soon as I am certain of the position held by the English. I shall advance straight against them with my old guard." Napoleon would have been more concerned than he was at the moment had he known that Grouchy had not left Gemblau until 6 o'clock that morning, and only by 11 o'clock he reached Walthen, where he had been halted for breakfast, following the orders of the 17th, only getting the new orders at 4 p.m. After seeing these orders Napoleon sent to Grouchy, Napoleon sent orders for Marbot of the 7th Hussars to take positions up by Frigermont, and sent out patrols to Lassancourt and to the bridges of Mortier and Ostend, not to look for Grouchy, but as an early warning sign of the approach of the Prussians. On the march, the Duke wrote a message to the English ambassador to the Kingdom of the Netherlands, Sir Charles Stuart, in Ghent, saying, "Pray keep the English quiet, if you can let them. Prepare to move out, but neither be in a hurry or a fright, as all will yet turn out well." Why he did this is revealed in a letter that he wrote to Lady Frances, an alleged mistress of his. "The course of operations may oblige me to uncover Brussels for a moment, and may expose it to the enemy. However, the rumor spread that the Allies were defeated and the Prussians were fleeing, and that Napoleon's army was advancing to Brussels, causing panic as the English rushed to get transport out of the city. Wellington wasn't as confident as Napoleon, and believed that if the Prussians did not arrive, he would fail, and facing what at the time was considered the best commander of the age, who could blame him? Even his friend, the Spanish ambassador to the Netherlands, Miguel de Alvara, was concerned that the Duke wasn't his confident self until the battle lines were drawn up, and the Duke nodded towards the French lines and said, "That little fellow doesn't know the licking he's in for." This could be rooted in the fact that the Duke had no way of knowing what Napoleon had planned. This is displayed when the Earl of Uxbridge, his second-in-command and commander of the cavalry, asked him what he had planned for the battle the next morning, and the Duke replied, "Who will attack tomorrow, I or Bonaparte?" Oxenbridge replied, Bonaparte. And the Duke said, well, if Bonaparte hasn't given me any ideas of his projects, and as my plans will depend upon his, how can you expect me to know what mine are? Oxenbridge wasn't his first. Napoleon's response was, because you've been beaten by Wellington, you consider him a good general. And now I will tell you that Wellington is a bad general, and the English are bad soldiers, and this affair will be over before lunch. Napoleon had to make these comments to uphold morale, as he knew Wellington's reputation. Another of these comments was, there are 90 chances in our favor. This is after Napoleon said after a battle, battles should not be fought if one cannot calculate at least 70% chance of victory. The two commanders made their battle plans in their respective headquarters, Napoleon in the nearby farmhouse of Le Caillou, and the Duke of Wellington in Brussels. While the two commanders were in their requisitioned buildings, most of the troops had to go through the rain and mud, as thunder and lightning crashed overhead. Horses picketed nearby in the wet soil broke free, galloping among the bivouac troops in whatever shelter they could find. Some of the troops were luckier than others. For example, William Gibney, a sergeant in the British cavalry, states, we were up to our knees in mud and stinking water. There was no choice. We had to settle down in the mud and filth as best we could, and those having any provisions about them were fortunate. As I had obtained a bit of tongue, but whether cooked immediately or smoked and salted, I know not. In the morning, I had a thimbleful of brandy in my flask, and I was better off than many. I looked about for a drier place to lie down. It was all mud, but we got some straw and boughs off trees, and with these tried to lessen the mud and make a rough shelter against the torrents of rain which fell all night. Wrapping around us our cloaks and huddling close together, we lay in the mud. Despite all this, the plucky fellow claims he slept like a top. Despite all this, the men still needed supplies, as John Gordon Smith, another cavalry surgeon, notes. Of the first, our men had received a supply. The horses had also been at least partially cared for, but the water there was a draw well close to the village of St.Jean, and that was the only resource to which thousands of thirsty ones had access. The first attack upon which was a loss, for snap went the rope and down fell the bucket, to a depth which it could not be recovered. Supported in the article of water, our attention was drawn to that of a fire, in producing of which we were eminently more successful. The adjoining village furnished fuel in abundance. Doors, windows, shutters, furniture of every description, carts, plows, harrows, wheelbarrows, clocks, casks, case tables, etc., etc., were carried or trundled into the bivouac, and, being broken up, made powerful fires in spite of the rain. Chairs were otherwise disposed of. Officers were paying 2 francs for each of them, and the men seemed at first to be able to keep up the supply. This at last failed, and for one I was fain to buy a bundle of straw in front of a field which horses occupied, round a miry cart road upon which officers' fires were kindled. And by the side of the road was a drain or shallow ditch. Here a party of us deposited our straw and resolved to establish ourselves for the night under the cover of cloaks. But such was the clayey nature of the bottom that the rain did not sink into the earth, but rose up like a leak in a ship among the straw, and we were, in consequence, more drenched from below than from above. Despite his soldiers' actions, the Duke of Wellington was fiercely opposed to pillaging, and punished offenders seriously to prevent making unnecessary enemies, seeing the effect the French troops had on the population of Spain, sparking the guerrilla war.
Here comes old Archie. Get your feet.
Your old friend, sir.
Ah, the Enniskillen. I hang and flog more of them than I do the rest of the army put together.
Good evening.
Good evening.
That's a fine night, sir. Take off your pack, sir.
Me, sir?
You, sir. Open it, sir.
Yes, sir.
Oh.
God! Jeez. I knew something queer was scratching me back, sir. Oh.
Where did you acquire this plunder, sir?
This, sir?
That, sir.
No, sir. This plunder acquired me, sir.
You know the penalty.
But the leave to pillage was not his orders, but the orders of Sir Frederick Adam. According to Second Lieutenant Richard Coxire of the Rifles, on the evening of the 17th, he was gathered around with his men, whom he described as like so many half-drowned and half-starved rats, when leave arrived from General Adam, who commanded our brigade to plunder three farmhouses. The idea of a fire was a most consoling one. Chairs, tables, sofas, cradles, churn, barrels, and all manner of combustibles were soon crackling in the flames. Our fellows then proceeded to slaughter all of the living stock the yard contained, and in less than an hour, we had a delicious breakfast of beef, pork, veal, duck, chicken, potatoes, and all other delicacies that I had ever made an attack on. Some of the men were even worse off. Private Matthew Clay, a guardsman, spent the night on the edge of a ditch in the shelter of a thick hedge with three other men, using his knapsack for pillow. All four of us crept undercover, taking the rest of our equipment with us. The storm continued with equal force, and our covering quickly became very quickly soaked, and some men were even forced to sleep in the open. Officers also had similar experiences despite their superior rank, but hid their complaints from veteran officers. As Captain Mercer, huddled with the other officers, wrote, "I know not how my bedfellows got on, as we all lay for a long while perfectly still and silent, the old peninsular hands disdaining to complain before the Johnny Newcomb comrades, and these fearing to do so, lest they should provoke remarks as, 'Lord have mercy on your tender carcass, what would such as you had done in the Pyrenees?' Or, 'Oh my boy, this is but child's play compared to what we saw in Spain.' So all who did not sleep, I believe the majority, pretended to do so, and bore their suffering with admirable heroism. Few troops had good sleep, neither did the generals despite their superior lodgings. As for campaigning so long, both Napoleon and Wellesley, as well as many of the senior officers, were sleep deprived. The Duke of Wellington only got 9.5 hours sleep in 3 days, and Napoleon even less, according to Sir John Keenan, and the rain fell on, pelting down the crops flat and flooding the ditches. But this was only the Allied army's experience, who were camped along the ridge since the day, and having some time to plunder. The French were far worse off, arriving.
Obviously, he's no student of Caesar. He's positioned himself badly. He's got the trees at his back. We'll give him no provocation. Maybe he'll leave tonight.
Throughout the first half of the night, cavalrymen attempting to sleep on the backs of their mounts as they marched in. Wellington's forces were able to hear the wagons and gun lumber wheels along the highway a mile away. Once the French troops arrived, they had little chance to scavenge for fuel, food, and water in the growing darkness, and must have envied the Allies' campfires along the opposing ridge. Dawn, Sunday, June 18th. Around 150,000 men descended upon the valley. It is impossible to give the exact numbers except for artillery, but Bernard Cornwell put Napoleon's army at 77,500 with the support of 246 artillery, and Wellington's force at 73,200 and 157 pieces of artillery, and Blücher hastily coming to Wellington's aid with a further 100,000 men and 240 artillery pieces, putting pressure on Napoleon to defeat Wellington quickly. Napoleon's advantage was his experienced troops. Wellington's was in his position. As his army varied in quality, Wellington had great faith in the British and King's German Legion, saying that he had just enough after the battle. However, Cornwell goes on to say that the rest of his troops, the Dutch, Belgians, and German troops, were of dubious quality, saying that they were untried and unexperienced, which is an unfair assessment, which can be said of all of the Allied army and French, as many of their units were watered down by new recruits and militiamen. The main reason for writing off these troops was lack in trust due to political differences over time by later historians, and at the time that many of the Dutch troops Jews had fought for Napoleon previously, and the Germans showing new waves of nationalism after their prior feudal systems had been destroyed. Napoleon's army, which was also a multinational force of Saxons, Poles, Bavarians, and Dutch Belgians, were also in not optimal conditions. Many of the soldiers lacked supplies. There was a lack of muskets, ammunition, harnesses, and horses. Some units' uniforms were in tatters or missing pieces. For example, the 29th Light Infantry in Durette's division under Delorme's corps served throughout the campaign with policemen's caps on their heads, and the 14th Light Infantry had been wearing the same canvas pants for over 3 years from 1813 to 15, regardless of the time of year. And finally, in more than 20 regiments, the men were without shoes, and their regiments were also, many of the troops of the French army did not trust their senior officers, as they suspected them of treason with the recent coup of the marshals after the war, and also that they used to lead the Royalist army. This led to many discipline problems. Napoleon's main advantage was in his artillery, in the numbers of it and its efficiency. Napoleon was an artilleryman by training, and called his guns his beautiful daughters. The fire from Napoleon's grand battery was so intense that Wellington's troops had to dismount and lie down.
Swinging his weight to you, Picton.
I've never seen guns move so smoothly.
Moves his cannon with the lightness of a pistol. I doubt a balance brigade will stand.
However, the British artillery was some of the best in Europe. As French General Foy wrote, frames, caissons, barrels, bullets, powder, every part of their equipage was remarkable for their goodness of materials, as well as the excellent workmanship. British gunners were well-trained and efficient and motivated. The British cavalry were well-mounted and well-trained. However, Wellington did not have the best opinion of them, stating, I considered our cavalry inferior to the French from want of order, that although I consider one squadron a match for two French, I didn't like to see four opposed to four French, and as the numbers increased, an order of course became more necessary, as I was unwilling to risk our men without having superiority in numbers. This also wasn't helped by Wellington's lack of heavy cavalry. But the battle would mostly be an infantry affair, as they were the battle winners, used to capture and hold ground when artillery was used to weaken a position and cavalry to disperse troops. Cavalry could in theory pierce deeply into the enemy ranks, but once done, were exposed to enemy cannon and musket fire and countercharges. However, Napoleon lost his advantages his men had due to Wellington's position and conditions. His troops had to advance in column over open ground for half a mile, slowed by the mud and under artillery fire, where the tight formations would be an excellent target for artillery, round and shell shot, only to come over the ridge to find infantry in lines preparing to volley fire and cannons preparing canister shots, then having to rush into line under intense fire. The mud also affected the artillery, as it slowed or even stopped the grazing shot, and that shell shot buried itself in the mud before exploding, lessening the damage or extinguishing the fuse. Howitzers were particularly notorious for this, as they fired in an arc. The French center was at La Belle Alliance, where the highway crossed the southern ridges. The ridges themselves were not parallel, forming an almost mirror image like a human eye. The eastern limits marked by the scattering of stone buildings and large farmsteads of Papelotte, La Haye, not to be confused with La Haison, Smohain, and Frischemont, all once garrisoned, made stone fortresses that could easily hold an area. The woods and countryside beyond these hills, cut by streams, would be easy to defend, anchoring Wellington's left flank. On the French right lay the village of Placenoir, a place not given much thought by the French troops, but later on in the day, the position would be critical. A minor road ran across the crest of the northern ridge, lined by hedges. Halfway down the ridge lay the farmhouse of La Haison in the Allied center. The farmhouse was garrisoned by the King's German Legion, infantry and light troops, and British riflemen nearby in a sandpit. The Chateau of Guemont, mistakenly called Hougoumont by Wellington, according to Sir Walter Scott, who visited the battlefield later in 1816, would be critical for holding the Allied right flank, as the land around it was far more open. It was garrisoned by Nassau Jaeger and the British Foot Guards. Beyond that, there were some reserves at the village of Brain. Allied, 17,000 men waited, ready to act as a rearguard if the battle was lost, or to hold the flank. As dawn came, the French could see the Allies on the ridge, though many were hidden on the reverse slopes. Napoleon spent most of the morning at La Belle Alliance. Unlike Wellington, who moved about the ridge inspecting his troops before returning to the elm tree near the crossroads at the center of the north ridge, three quarters of a mile lay between the two armies. As the troops made ready for battle, the weather improved. The rain stopped, except for passing showers, throughout the day. Despite this being a summer's day, the morning was bitterly cold. Johnny Kincaid's rifles made tea in a large cauldron, and according to Kincaid, all the bigwigs of the army had the occasion to pass. I believe everyone, from the Duke downward, claimed a cupful. The French were in no better shape. Louis Candler, an 18-year-old infantryman, spent the night, but in the morning, butchering a sheep, boiled it with the rest of his troop with some flour to thicken the broth, but there was no salt for seasoning, and so one soldier in desperation threw in gunpowder, taking saltpeter as a more literal meaning. Candler recalls that the mutton tasted foul. Private Matthew Clay had a similar experience. We procured some fuel from the farm of Hoover, and then lightened a fire and warmed ourselves, our limbs very much cramped, sitting on the side of a wet ditch the entire night. The sergeant of each section gave a small piece of bread, which was about an ounce, to each man, and an inquiry was made along the ranks for a butcher. Later, a pig was slaughtered and a carcass cut out, Clay getting a piece of the head scorched and found it inedible. And so he readied his musket, which was loaded, as many of the garrison of Hougoumont feared a night attack. He cleared the barrel by firing it into a nearby bank, checked his ammunition to make sure it was dry, tightened the musket's dog head, which carried the flint, and oiled the spring. Scenes similar to this would be played out by all troops on either side of the valley, as troops experienced what John Keenan called the urge to get it over and done with. One 16-year-old British infantry officer by the name of George Cavill spent his time in what he called the dreary interval between daylight and the first cannon shot, constantly wishing for the fight that would be fought. The men in both armies constantly cleaning their weapons, fearing the uncertainty of the battle ahead, fear of death, wounds, and showing fear to their comrades, constantly cleaning and readying their weapons, trying to dry their uniforms and ammunition, and getting whatever food they could. Both armies were cold, damp, and stiff. Captain William Vernon of the 7th Hussars to a fellow officer said, "If I look half as bad as you do, then I must be a miserable-looking fellow." And Sergeant Duncan Robertson of the 92nd Highlanders reckoned, "I never felt colder in my life." But the British troops were revived a little when a gin ration was issued. Assistant Surgeon Hattie of the 1st Lifeguards recalls, "Everyone was covered in mud, and it was with great difficulty that the men managed to get fires lit, some breakfast cooked, arms cleaned, and their ammunition dried. Several hours passed quickly. The weather improved and later the sun came out. Mostly we were waiting and still." William Gidney of the 15th Hussars writes, "We were urged to bridle up and prepare for action. This we did in dark and with discomfort, but a night spent in the pouring rain, sitting up to our hips in muddy water with straw bits hanging about him, does make a man feel and look queer. On first rising, indeed, it was almost ludicrous to observe the various countenances of us officers smoking cigars and occasionally shivering as we stood around a watch fire, giving out more smoke than heat. It was tedious work waiting for orders. We were anxious to be put into motion. If it were only to circulate the blood for both horses and men, we were both sharing the cold." At 6 a.m., the Duke rode from Brussels to the ridge of Mont St.Jean, getting a cup of tea from Kincaid's rifles and ordering loopholes to be hacked into the garden wall at Hougoumont. But the French did not attack. Napoleon's gunners declared the ground to be too wet, as a cannon would recoil, digging itself into the mud, and it would be difficult to return them to their firing positions.
"I'm not asleep, Duro."
"Sire, we need 4 hours. The ground is too soft. I cannot move my cannon."
"If I waited 4 hours, I would have lost the Battle of Austerlitz."
"Wellington won't hold us an hour. Not with that bouillabaisse of his. English, Brunswickers, Belgians, and God knows what else."
"Sire, I cannot answer for my cannon."
"You are the cannon, Duro."
"If we could attack at 12, it would be better."
"Battles are lost in 1.25 hours.
"If Wellington were on the move, then I would say, go now. But he is sitting, sire, with the mud in his favor."
So Napoleon delayed 2 and then 3 hours to let the ground dry. Soult suggested to attack sooner due to the Prussians. However, Napoleon scorned the idea. While they waited, the French played mind games with the Allied army, trying to overawe them. Colonel John Dickinson of the Royal Scots Greys recalls, "It was daylight, and the sun every now and then sending brief flashes of light through the broken clouds. As I stood behind the straggling hedge and low beech trees that skirted the high banks of the sunken road, on both sides, I could see the French army drawing up in heavy two masses opposite me. They were only a mile from where I stood, but the distance seemed greater, for between the mist-filled hollows there were great columns of infantry, and squadron after squadron of cuirassiers, red dragoons, brown hussars, and green lancers, with little swallow-tail flags on the end of their lances. The grandest sight was a regiment of cuirassiers, dashing at full gallop over the brow of the hill opposite me, with the sun shining on their steel breastplates. It was a splendid show. No one who saw it could forget it. There was a sudden roll of drums along the whole enemy line, and a burst of music came from the bands of 100 battalions. And a burst of music from the bands of 100 battalions came to me on the wind. Then every regiment began to move. They were taking a position to battle. Johnny Kincaid, 95th Rifles. We saw Buonaparte himself take post at the side of the road immediately in our front, surrounded by numerous staff and each regiment as they passed, and numerous staff, and each regiment as they passed rent the air with shouts of Vive l'Empereur, nor did they cease after they passed, but backed by the thunder of their artillery and the carrying with them the rub-bump of drums and the tut-tut-tut-tut-tut of trumpets, in addition to their increasing shouts of it looked at first as if they had some hope of scaring us off the ground, in singular contrast to the stern silence reigning on our side. Some observers said that young untried troops stood pale-faced and trembling at this. The veterans of the Peninsula War had seen it all before, and so did not react. Yet they waited and stood their arms. No one moved. Napoleon in this time sent orders to Grouchy. The Emperor directs me to tell you that at this moment His Majesty is going to attack the English army, which has taken position at Waterloo. Thus His Majesty desires that you direct your movements on Wavre in order to draw near us. Place yourself in touch with our operations and link up your communications with us, driving before you those portions of the Prussian army that have taken this direction and may have stopped at Wavre, where you should arrive as soon as possible. You will follow the enemy column on your right, using some light troops to observe their movements and gather up their stragglers. Inform me immediately about your dispositions and your march, also any news of the enemy, and do not neglect to link up your communications with us. The Emperor desires to have news from you very often. This order was mainly nonsense. Grouchy, however, seized upon the command to move to Wavre. Napoleon probably wanted his force getting between Blücher and Waterloo, while getting him closer to Napoleon. The order of hurting the Prussians would not be successful, as they were not on his right, but to his front and driving left. The Prussians were going toward Napoleon, opposed to away from them. Grouchy could have held the Prussians, as there was a steep bank between Wavre and Waterloo, but the French might not have known about its existence, and so the opportunity was missed. Eventually, Napoleon's gunners deemed the ground to be dry enough, and so around 11, a cannon fired, opening the Battle of Waterloo. It is not known from what side, but it is generally accepted that the cannon was a French gun on Napoleon's left at around 11:20.
We'll begin the attack there. At Hougomont.
Well, that opens the ball.
35 minutes past 11.
Thank you, gentlemen. Return to your positions.
Return to your positions!